Pauls. Good morning.
Bonjour. Annie. Welcome. Wingash, our Ojibwe word for our sweetgrass. I thought in these tumultuous times, these days of great difficulties, of lots of hurts, pains, and of and thoughts of anger and fears, and at times also of sheer hatred, that in thinking about what to bring to you today, that I thought I would actually, which I had to do for myself, to really pay attention again to the gifts that Creator had provided for us as indigenous folks to help us see us through days and times as we are doing now. So I thought I'd bring you some teachings on the sweetgrass, on the wingash.
We at St. Paul's United Church would like to acknowledge that we are located on Treaty 6 territory and respect the histories, languages, and cultures of First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and all First Peoples of Canada, whose presence continues to enrich our vibrant community.
Come, let us sing of a wonderful love, tender and true, tender and true, out of the heart of the Father above, streaming to me and to you. Wonderful love, wonderful love, dwells in the heart of the Father above. Jesus the Savior, this gospel to tell, joyfully came, joyfully came, came with the helpless and hopeless to dwell, sharing the sorrow and shame, seeking the lost, seeking the lost, saving, redeeming at measureless cost. Come to my heart, O the wonderful love, come and abide, come and abide, lifting my life till it rises above envy and falsehood and pride, seeking to be, seeking to be lowly and humble, a learner of thee.
The first reading chosen for today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 19, verse 14, taken from the New International Version. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." The next reading also comes from Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 to 15. Using Bible commentaries, we find these: "Many parents were bringing children for him to place his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples," and we could substitute priest, nuns, governments of the day, "the disciples of today, felt that this was a waste of Jesus' time, and they began rebuking those for bringing children. Apparently, the disciples had already forgotten what Jesus had said earlier about the worth of children and the seriousness of causing them to fall. Jesus rebuked the disciples, telling them to let the little children come and not hinder them." From the New International Version, we read Romans chapter 12, verses 17 to 21. "Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. And in doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Christine Jarrett writes in her piece titled, "Layers of Forgiveness in Faithfully Yours," "I've come to a place of believing that forgiveness is a matter of putting this broken relationship into God's hands, trusting God to deal with the persons who have done the hurting, trusting God to redeem even this experience and weave into my life in creative ways."
Faith of our fathers living still, in spite of dungeon, fire, and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whenever we hear that glorious word. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to you till daring faith, your work for Christ is love revealed, spreading God's word from pole to pole, making love known and freedom real. Faith of our mothers, holy faith, we will be true to you till death. Faith of our sisters, brothers too, who still must bear oppression's might, raising on high in prisons dark the cross of Christ still burning bright. Faith for today, O living faith, we will be true to you till faith born of God, oh, call us yet, bind us with all who follow you, sharing the struggle of your cross until the world is made anew. Faith born of God, oh, living faith, we will be true to you.
We have three chords, to the braid, as you know, and especially, of course, the women, if you have a chance to braid your hair, you do it with three, mainly, I believe, to start off with. And so we have the three cords, each braid. I have, on rare occasions, seen a double braided cord, which is quite incredible if you ever have a chance to see that. And you might really come across those some days when you're at the truly all-traditional powwows, where they dance for the people and not in competition. Sometimes you will see the braids, the double braids there. So each braid, the cords are represented of the mind, body, spirit, love, peace, harmony. The seven braids, which make up each cord, and if you ever have a chance and you go picking yourself or braid it together or you learn with others, you will see that there's 7 or 14 or 21 that make up each of the three individual braids before they braid it together. So for those, we have representations always of our spirit animals, of our helpers, as we call them. And so in Ojibwe, we have our Ma'iagon, which is the wolf, which brings humility. We have Makwa, the bear, which brings us our courage. We have the Kichisabe, which is the honesty. We have, for wisdom, Amik, our beaver. In truth, we have my own clan, Mejake, turtle. And for respect, we have that greatest helper for indigenous people of all, the Mashkude Biziki, the buffalo. And love, we have the Megazam, which is our eagle. It also represents strength, which is more of the masculine energy. One strand of sweetgrass can be easily broken, but when the sweetgrass is braided, it is almost impossible to break it. Strength is in family, and the strength in the community is what the sweetgrass medicine teaches us and what it represents. Now we know why sweetgrass is so important as a sacred medicine for us. There are many other teachings with the sweetgrass, and one of the main ones is that we learn, for us that are in this process of coming home, when we come back to our original teachings and we come and try to find a little bit that we never knew or that had been lost. And so we also learn within those teachings that the sweetgrass is the most sacred because it's the hair of Sky Woman. It is the hair of Skugmekwe, Turtle Island, on which we live, who gives us our place here on her back. So it's extremely sacred. It has to be clean. It has to be unknotted. It's brushing. It's like our own hair. You know, we look after our own hair because we don't want it to be dirty. We don't want it to be oily and all of those things. And it's got to be clean. And it's the same for the sweetgrass, because if you look at it perhaps in a way too, that if the sweetgrass is dirty, if it's stuck together, if it's clumpy or because of mud or because of knots in there, it's the same as the sweetgrass on the earth. It's hard to walk through, it's hard to tread on, it's hard to have a good walk. You might actually get caught on the sweetgrass and trip, which especially for our elders is always very dangerous. So we look after the sweetgrass, and we must. I also today very much thought our little ones, they never had the chance to stroke the sweetgrass hair of their mothers. They never had the chance to feel what that is like. The mums, the mothers, never had the chance to braid the hair of their girls and their boys. And as a mother and as a father, you know what that is like to be able to stroke the hair of your child, or that child at times to play with your hair. It's that intricacy, that intrinsic gift of Creator, that bond that we have. And right now, of course, as we know, the sweetgrass was ripped So when we go picking, when the time of harvesting for sweetgrass happens, what we do is, it's one of the medicines, you don't pull it, you cut it. You don't pull out the roots, because what happens with the roots, it is also the umbilical cord. It's the umbilical cord of our lives. It's the umbilical cord of Skagmekwe, Turtle Island, and Creator. So if we rip it by the roots and the roots just come out, what happens is it's damaged. So that spirit will be damaged. The spirit will be in hurt, it'll be in pain. It may have a really tough or rough life ahead of them when that happens. So we have to be careful and cautious. And like any medicines, and many of you have heard these teachings over the years now, whenever we go pick something, we don't clear out a whole area. You know, you do a little bit here, a little bit over there. And we put that tobacco down, that asema, first as a gift. And we tell them, we're going to take some of you to bring them home to help us in our daily lives, to know what that would be like, to help us heal. We can make tea with sweetgrass. It cleanses, but it calms and soothes us. It's like the stroking of the mother's hair. That's exactly the same. So that's why the sweetgrass is so important. I had to lay mine aside these last 2 months on purpose, which I've never done in my 30 years now of walking this red road. Because in my heart, I was holding a lot of anger. In my heart, I was holding there was a lot of hatred that had come in. And when I'm in that way, I'm not to be near our medicines. So I have to put it aside. So personally, these 2 months, I have really had to think long and hard about the line in Romans 12, 17 through 21 that was read for us this morning. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. I have, as many people across these lands, coast to coast, the last few days, had to consciously exercise the wisdom in my anger, in my rages. For 2 weeks, daily moments of floods of tears. Tears for our little ones, tears for me still being here. Tears for you. Tears that I was spared going into the RS schools. Tears too for the churches. Tears in understanding that for the first time in my life, somewhat of his last words that allegedly he spoke of, for the first time an understanding in my life deeply of I think what he meant with, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. He died on the cross. My little ones, because of that, too. I also really have to think and I would stay at home. I would lock myself in. I didn't want to see anybody in those times anyway, but I have to be very conscious too that I do not take on Creator's work. It is not for me or for us to take over that which is not mine and ours to do so. Having to listen again and again the last two months now, almost again, to photo op given apologies by leaders and prime ministers who jump on the bandwagon once again. To hear and read all over social media and newscasters selling once again First Nations Indigenous traumas because it is good print. Oh, them poor Indians again. Having to listen and hear and read and learn of, again, using the words of recent discoveries. A discovery of what? A technological dig? An archaeological dig? A treasure of some historical bones of an ancient people that was suddenly discovered? The angers and deep disappointments in the facts that very few have really, and that does include many in the churches of all denominations, have not read the TRC findings. That has become real obvious these 2 months. And it appears that the ones that were left out in having really read about, perhaps conveniently so, are the calls to the church 71 through 79. You were told long before the start of the TRC hearings for decades of the ongoings in our schools, of clandestine burial grounds, where play areas and skating rinks should have been. Government and church sanction ongoing policies to this day, to this very morning. The Indian Act, our status cards, CFS, a thinly disguised, very much ongoing residential school policies, government sanctioned, written in government policy. The white paper, housing policies. About heaven and hell, I had to, and I did, really have to look into myself, into my very heart, again these last weeks, days, as to why at this time am I going into ministry? What is there for me to really, as an Indigenous person and my whole life being part of the church, why would I still find it worthwhile or a personal need to try to bring in at this reconciliation? In light of the discovery of hundreds of our little ones, and it still is only the tip of the iceberg, and we know that. All those stories are in the TRC findings. They are in all the stories that were recorded leading up to the final report. Our people everywhere have always spoken about that for decades. It's not nothing new. It is definitely not historical. The last one closed in 1997, a scant 25, 30-ish years ago. Our little ones who were told stories of heaven while literally tossed into the furnaces in the basement of the Irish schools in some cases. They were taught of a different faraway place that was foreign to them, different than what many of them would have still possibly remembered at times of their own creation stories with their own various different First Nations. What they heard and what they learned and what they saw was not the place where Sky Woman came from. It is not the place of where we speak of, it is the Anishinaabeg, about the place where our lodges are, the Nishwase Mishonsake, the Nishwase Nukmishak, the seven grandmothers and seven grandfathers' lodges. That is somewhere out there in the sky world, in spirit. It's somewhere, we would also can say, of course, is in heaven. But it was different than what those children were taught and shown. They were not read bedtime stories, fairy tales. I think few, if any, of the caretakers and the priests and the nuns that worked in the schools told them created a tale of a fantasy of dragons and swordsmen and Robin Hoods as bedtime stories for them. They had no bedtime stories. And they certainly didn't have their mothers to stroke her hair. So it was also at that time for the first time that my people learned of a different concept of hell. We don't have that. We don't have that in any of our First Nations stories or creation stories. We have kind of below, but the whole idea of a hell, as we have learned about in Christianity, it is something completely different. They were just all our little ones, our little people. And they never knew what they had done wrong. They never knew. In the name of a Christ, in the name of Christ. Are these really the teachings of Creator Self, or are they quote-unquote additions that were inserted by the first translators, the first people that wrote the stories down and that became the various chapters and Bibles and stories of the Bible? Were they written in order to truly control the people? As many of us know, in various parts in our daily lives, in our work lives, even on holidays sometimes, you know. Many people out there quickly use the word, you know, you're going to hell if you don't do this, if you don't do that. Sometimes as parents we might use that with our teenagers who are running rampant. I think a big change that would come, and I've spoken about this many times for quite a few years now, in reconciliation is, and especially within the church, I think sometimes the narrative, a word used, need to consciously change. It must. I tried to recall, and with my sister, I don't ever really remembering mom and dad, and it's, you know, for those that don't know me, I come from a very European Dutch minister's household. I don't ever remember mom and dad really talking or using the word of hell. And they certainly never used it to keep us in line. I and we all must leave Jesus to be the one to rebuke the disciples that hindered the pathways of the children. The nuns, the priests, the Indian agents, governments, it cannot be for me to take that on. So I will light the Christ candle. I, on purpose, snuffed it out at the beginning of my walk. For was it because of his death that they had to die? The very ones who were to be in the image of God and Jesus, their teachings, they were the very ones who snuffed out that sacred fires and all those little ones before they had a chance to burn bright. So I will light the Christ candle, and I have picked up the wingash again, and I do that with you. I do it for them, for me, for you. I am ready. I pray, ask, are you ready? There is work to be done, much. But I also know I cannot stay in grief and lose myself. Our people know that, coast to coast. We have done the ceremonies coast to coast so far. We have brought them back to the Western doorway. We have our young ones here with us today that we need to look after. And I need to look after our elders who did come home. We need to bring our little ones to the Western doorway so they may be at Creator's side once again in that Zakdivan, in that love. The sweetgrass, too, is forgiveness. It is forgiveness, it is love, it is kindness, it is strength. For you all. Kachima Gretch. I am Oshka Bayless. I am Skodans Nene. I am Wabshkiki Gabo. I am Ganigahaga Horemishone. I am Mejike Dodem. I am Nishmanatuwak. I am a Dewan. I am Scoot. I am a second intergenerational RS survivor. I'm a European adoptee. I am a Christian. I am RW. Kichime Kwech. Nikarigana. Aha.
Bring them home, bring them home.
üzemledi. Iu name Ivanan maba asema minwa de unanem gde agit nimogam migwech gde igom nimeshomes nishanek minwa nukmes sinajek ji inango ga iajek mugom e iajek nugom e iajek minwa wabam ge iajek mikwech manadom iajek nude nam iajek a being iaj koden minwa iajek akin mikwech manadom iajek givat nam wabanam zaunam minwa apengishmak tiga be we idok ka wishinam we e mina bamadije yam aha kachimikwet. We offer our prayers to Baco and our hearts. Thank you for the grandfathers and the grandmothers of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Thank you, spirits of the winds, the water, fire, and earth. Thank you, spirits, the west, the east, the south, and the north. Please help us to live a good life. Kichimekwach. Amen.